Hello and welcome back to part 2 of this series of videos on how to build the gmail.com landing page mini project. Again, it's a great mini front-end web project that you can put on your resume and impress your recruiters. Alright, it's a 7-part series. So in each video, we typically look at one feature or we try to implement one design pattern. And we do this so that you have enough time to kind of catch up with us. Alright, so don't forget to code along with us. And if you want feedback, come sign up on the Edis Webmaster Bootcamp, where we do a lot more videos like this. The link is in the description below. And if you'd like the code for this entire project, you'll also find that in the bootcamp. So go ahead, sign up and reach out to me on the Edis chat if you need any help. In this video, we're going to take a look at how to design the nav bar for our landing page. It's a very common UI element that you see in almost every website. And in this video, we're going to take a look at exactly how gmail.com, their landing page, how do they build their nav bar? And we're going to try and build it the same way ourselves. Excited? Let's get to it.
All right. So here's the thing. Every great website, okay, at the end of the day, starts with one file. Okay. One very simple file called index.html. Okay. So go ahead, create that file. Very simple here. You guys are, you were born with technology, so I don't have to explain like small things to you. I'm pretty sure. Just go to file, click on new file, and just control S to save it. Okay. So every website in the world starts with a very, very simple index.html file. Okay. And generally, how do you, so if you have any experience, if you know even a little bit about how HTML works, okay, and how websites are made, you know that it's very simple to get started, right? The first thing that they tell you to do with HTML is to write this tag called as HTML, right? So you do something like this, then, people usually have something called as a head tag, okay? And then people have something called as a body tag. And in the body tag, you could say something like, welcome team Edis. All right. For those of you who don't really understand how HTML or CSS is written, again, just a quick disclaimer, it's nothing complex at all. Okay. In HTML, you have this concept of tags. Okay. Everything that you put or you want to draw on the web page. For instance, if you want to draw this image, right, then you will need an HTML tag for that, called an image tag. If you wanted to add some paragraphs, you would need a paragraph tag. Okay. So that's how you draw things in the browser. Okay. If you want to draw an image, you use the image tag in HTML. If you want to draw a button, you use the button tag in HTML. Right. So that's all we are doing. I'm just showing you, this is typically how you start, right? This is typically how you write HTML. Now, how do you view it on a browser? Okay. The first thing that you'll probably do is open a new tab, Control O to open. Okay. And then you would go to wherever that index.html is, right? You will double click on that. And there you go. There you can see, that, oh, hey, welcome team Edis. This is also welcome team Edis. That's fantastic, right? So let me just, keep it side by side so you guys can see it better. Now, suppose instead of welcome team Edis, you want to, go ahead and say add an image, okay? Or you want to go ahead and add a heading, all right? So I'm just going to say something like, give me a first level heading, okay? Most important heading on the page. And what do I want to do there? I just want to do something like, hello world, all right? So I go ahead and I save it, and you'll notice that nothing really changed over here, okay? And so actually I have to go and I have to click on this refresh button, and then you can see that, the text comes over here, right? So again, if you have to go back and say, oh, it's not hello world, sorry, it's actually hello Edis. All right. If you had to do something like that, then again you would have to go back and again you would have to refresh, right? And for this small contrived example, it's actually fine. You can go and refresh 2-3 times. Not like it will kill you. but with VS Code, you can do something really wonderful, okay? With VS Code, what you can do is... just 1 second. Yeah. So you can press this thing called... It has a shortcut, okay? You do Alt-L and then Alt-O, okay? And then it's going to load your web page in the browser directly. Okay, you don't even have to go to the browser, open it or whatever. Okay, now the beauty is, instead of edist, if I wanted to write Abhinandan, okay, the minute I save, you see that the text over here will start to change. So if I say hello Abhinandan here, immediately it changes. Okay, I don't have to keep switching back and forth. All right, just install the live server extension. Open your index.html file, and I'm just going to press, I'm going to tell you what the, okay, and then press Alt L and Alt O, okay, and this will open up the web page in your browser, okay, but the beauty is, now you don't have to keep refreshing your browser again and again, okay, you just make your changes in the HTML file, click on save, like control S, and it'll just show up here. Okay. And that's magical. So you don't really need an extension for auto saving, Sai. In VS Code, there's a way you can configure it. Okay. So you can just press the F1 key, F1 function one. Okay. And then you could, you know, just go to something like settings. So something like open settings, okay, in open settings UI, and then you could search for something like save, all right? And then you have all of these options. So for instance, it has files auto save. So you could have something like, just save it after a little bit of delay, okay? So instead of Abhinandan, if I used to say edist, but now I'm not saving anything, the file itself will start to auto save after a bit, okay? I generally don't like that behavior because suppose I'm in the middle of editing a tag, I mean, my tag is not correct, and then it autosaves, kind of messes this up a bit, all right? So I generally keep it to off. I just press Control S every time I want to save something. All right, so guys, just a quick check before we get started with the actual code, all right? Do you have Visual Studio installed? And do you have the live server installed? Okay, these are two things that I want you to do. All right, install VS Code. Install live server extension. Okay. Make index.html. Alt L and then Alt O. Okay, this is the keyboard shortcut to opening up this live server. So just give me a yes on the chat if you guys are able to do this. All right, guys, 37 participants, and I have about it's about 10 yeses. Okay, guys, if you face any issues at all, please let me know. Okay, I'm here to help. This is a workshop. This is not a class. In your college, or this is not a webinar on YouTube. Okay, I really want you guys to build a web page by the end of this. All right, it's all right even if you don't build the exact web page, okay, or the best web page. That's fine, that's perfectly fine. All right, I just want you to build something that looks like this. Okay, anything is fine, really. All right, and you will always have time to go back and make it much better. All right. Right, guys, then let us get started. All right. Supriya, are you trying to ask a question? I'm sorry, everyone's on mute. So if you have a question to ask, please ask it on the chat. All right. ठीक है, सो वी गोइंग टू गेट स्टार्टेड. ओके, आई होप यू गाइज आर सुपर पम्प्ड, सुपर एक्साइटेड, बिकॉज वी आर गोइंग टू बी बिल्डिंग समथिंग दैट गूगल इंजीनियर्स बिल्ड. ओके, दिस इज नॉट समथिंग दैट सम इंटर्न वेंट एंड मेड. ओके, द बेस्ट ऑफ द डिजाइनर्स आर ऑन दिस, द बेस्ट ऑफ देयर वेब डेवलपर्स आर ऑन दिस, एंड इफ दे कैन बिल्ड दिस, sorry, if we can also build something like this, imagine the kind of confidence it's going to give you. Okay, what a brilliant thing to do. So, okay, so just going to go back. This is the page that you need to be on. Okay, bit.ly address Gmail. I'm going to end up closing this. All right, closing my slides for now. This is the reference design, right? This is what we need. Okay, yeah, Sai, we are going to go ahead and I'll show you how to build a responsive website towards the end of it, okay? Geeta, you're not able to run. Please explain once again. Okay, so the first step is to download VS Code, okay? Were you able to download that? Okay, yeah, Abhishek, I'll come to your question in just a bit, okay? Okay, Geeta, you created the index.html file, right? Wonderful. Can you add some tags to it? So, for instance, in VS Code, here's a cool trick, okay? Just type in HTML and then you can see these three things pop up, right? So just click on one of them, okay? And you'll see that it automatically generates some HTML for you, okay? So go ahead and call this, Gmail is the title of the page, and in the body, just keep a heading for now, okay? And let's say welcome Edis, okay? Let's keep that as the heading, okay? Then do Alt L. Alt O, okay, that's the extension that I showed you. It's called Live Server. So go ahead and you'll have to download that. Okay, if for some reason you're not able to download, just go to the browser, press Control O, and open your index.html file. Okay, the only thing is you'll have to go ahead and keep refreshing it every time you make a change here. You have to go back and make a change over there. Okay, so that way is also fine. Vaishnavi, I'm not sure what you said, how to have a server extension. The extension that I'm using is called Live Server. Okay, but that's for reloading this demo. All right. So is that what you were asking? Oh, okay, Sakshi, that's really weird, because in VS Code, it generally comes by itself. Are you on Windows? This is something that you'll have to debug. Probably I can take a look at it during the lunch section. All right, but I want to go ahead and get started with the web page. All right, Vaishnavi and Geeta, are you able to follow now? All right, just create an index.html file, open it in the browser. Okay, that's literally all you have to do. Every time you make a change here, go ahead and keep refreshing. Okay. All right, so the first thing that you'll notice about this web page, okay, is that this, you know, because my browser is kind of half of my screen, something very interesting is going to happen, okay? Notice that the nav bar, okay, the thing on top over here, notice that it's different when you're on something like a mobile, okay? Versus if I were to make this much bigger, okay? So if it's on a laptop, this is going to look different. Whereas if you're on a mobile, so just notice the part where it switches, okay? So if it's this big, whatever device you're on, okay? It can be a tablet, it can be a laptop, anything that is this, that has this much space, okay? For that, the Gmail landing page has just the one nav bar at the top, all right? And also pay attention to this bit here, this get more done with Gmail, okay? You'll notice that it's in two columns, right? But the minute that there is not enough space, okay, which means this goes inside here, okay? Notice what happened now. The navbar has become two navbars, okay? And this section over here also has become like, it's become one column, okay? Earlier it was two columns. Now it's just one column. There are other small things that also change. For instance, take a look at the size of this get more done with Gmail. Okay. the minute I make it this a little bigger, okay, just resize my browser window, this becomes much bigger. Okay, this little bit of magic is called responsive web design. Okay, basically what that means is you find a way to, you know, on you write code only one time. Okay, you either write it for mobile or you write it for the desktop, but you write index.html is only there once. But depending on where you see index.html, it will look and behave very differently. Okay, and that's wonderful because on mobile phones, you don't have so much space that you can do things side by side. On mobiles, it's very simple. There's not enough space, so you keep things one after the other. Whereas on web, on desktops, on, you know, those big, beautiful 4K monitors, there's a lot of horizontal space, right? So imagine how difficult, boring, and, you know, just tedious it will be if for every sort of device in the world, I have to write my HTML again and again. Okay, I have to write for a phone, but there are different types of phones. There's your Android, there's iOS. Even in Android, there are 6 inches phones, 4 inches phones. Laptops, they come in variety of resolutions. It's going to get very difficult if you have to write HTML for every single device. Okay, it's not possible almost. Which is why this entire, you know, this way of doing HTML is so brilliant. Okay, it's so nice because you write code once and then just a little bit of, you know, just a little bit of code that you have to add towards the end. And then it'll automatically change things when it's on mobile versus on desktop. Okay. And I'm excited to show you that towards the end of this workshop, right? So we're going to see how we can get that effect. Okay. So from desktop all the way to, you know, to mobile. All right. So I was thinking what we'll start off with. Okay. The code that we write for now, we'll design for the mobile first. Okay. And why is that the case? Because it's much simpler to design it that way. Okay. It's all in one column. We can just quickly go and just, you know, quickly add all of this. Okay. Before you know it, our mobile page will be done. Okay. Will it look good on a desktop? Probably not. When there's a lot of space, everything coming in one column will not look that good. But we'll see how to go ahead and fix that. Okay. All right. So I'm assuming you guys have some experience with HTML. So I won't go through every single tag in a lot of detail. Just checking in case you guys have any. Okay. All right. Okay. So we'll get started. Okay. We'll get started by making the header and the footer. Okay. So we'll get started by building those two out. So let's go ahead and do this. Okay. Alt L Alt O, just so that it opens up here. Let's see what we want. We want this little image. Okay. So I'm not going to use any new images. Okay. I'm just, because I want to build this web page, I'm going to use Google's own images. Okay. So you can right click on an image and you can say copy image address. Okay. And that will give you the link to that image. All right. So we'll start off with a very simple structure. Okay. For a web page that I generally use. I have a header tag and a footer tag. Okay. These are the first two tags that I usually write. Okay. Header is going to contain this guy over here. Whereas footer is going to contain all of this stuff, all right? So header and footer, those are the two things that I want to build right away. So the first thing that you can see is I want to have this image inside my header, okay? So I'd go ahead and say image, this is my source, and let's just say logo, all right? And you can see that over here, we have this image. Okay. The only problem is, again, this is tiny. This is really, really big. We'll go ahead and fix that in just a bit. Okay. But my job is to just get everything on the page. And then slowly, slowly, I'll start styling it. Right after image, what do you have? You have this text called as Gmail, right? So I can probably put that inside a span. I'm just going to say Gmail. And let's see what else we have. We have a link over here called Get Gmail. Okay. So let's make a link there. I mean, guys, I know it looks like a button, okay, but it's actually you can make a link, an HTML link. Okay, so this is how it will start to look. Looks ugly, that's fine. Be patient. Give it 5 minutes. Once we start adding the styles, it's going to look much better. Okay. And after that, what do we need? After that, we need this for work and the sign in, right? We need these two things, for work and sign in. So let's make two more links. So I'm going to call this for work, and this I'm going to call as sign in. All right. So let's see, do we have everything that's there over here? Content wise? Yes, we have all the content we need. Does it look like this? Obviously not, but we'll fix that. Let's go down all the way to the footer, okay? This bit over here. So there's obviously like a, I mean, this is an image, right? Okay, so you can't really copy this image because it's an SVG. So in my footer tag here, okay, I'm going to start arranging all of these guys, okay? So the first thing I want is probably I could search for Google logo. Okay, because I want that Google logo at the very end, right? So let's go with something like Google logo transparent. Let's see, this seems all right. So again, create an image over here. Okay, that will be our logo, and you can see that. Okay, because use this image. So let's see if we can find a better image. Yeah, this might be okay. So a lot of this is it's a little trial and error based, but yeah, I think this is slightly better, right guys? Slightly better than what we had. I mean, it's too big, okay? Also, it's like really, really light. So maybe this is the one that we're looking for. Okay, so just search around for whatever image you think is best, okay? And again, these images are way too big right now. We'll go ahead and we'll fix all of that, all right? Then what do you have here, okay? You pretty much have like a list of links. Okay, so let's see, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we have about 6 links. So go ahead, make a UL tag. Okay, UL is for list, unordered list. And then you have 6 different list elements, right? So you have something like privacy. Then you have terms. Then you have about Google. You have Google products. Our policy. And finally, privacy and security. Okay. Let's see. So we have the Google image here. We have a bunch of these guys. Okay. So let's see what's left. So we're left with this, okay, this sort of select dropdown that you can use to choose languages. And we are kind of left with this this button called as the help button, right? So again, what do we need there? Probably we need another link, right, for this, and we'll call it help, okay? I'm not going to use the, so this button, this question mark, we're going to add it in just a bit, okay? So we'll just add the link over there, and then we'll add like a select, okay? So basically a select is what I use to make a drop down, like this. Okay, I mean, I don't know if you can see, it's at the very end of the screen. All right, I just want to give a bunch of options to my user, right? And these are all languages that I want to add. So I could say something like English, you know, let's go with three languages. Let's keep it simple. English, French, Hindi, right? So you notice that we now have like, it's just zooming in a little bit. So you'll notice that we have the help link that we had over here. Okay. And we also have like a drop-down of stuff, right? So we have this drop-down, English, French, and Hindi. Right, I'm going to take just a minute in case you have any questions for me right now. Please ask that on the chat, okay? Everything that we've done so far is like really, really, it's simple to follow along, okay? We didn't do like a bunch of different things, okay? You just make your simple HTML, you just add it. You don't really need these, okay? Even if you didn't have them, it's fine. The important bit is this, okay? You have to have a body tag, okay? Inside body, the structure is going to be header. Make a header tag, then make a footer tag, okay? And inside the header, I just want you to keep adding the images that, you know, that Google has. Okay. So this is what a header looks like. It has a nice image here. Then we keep the text Gmail over here inside a span element. And then the button, okay, called get Gmail. It's a button, but again, I use it as a link. Okay. Because when you hover over this, for instance, you can see that, you know, you can see that there's a link at the bottom of the screen. When you hover over this, you can see that there's a link at the bottom of the screen, right? So that's what you need, okay? These are all the elements that we want to have, okay? We'll make it look pretty, but that's the second part of things, okay? The first part is to just get everything on the page. And then we start slowly, we start making it look pretty. Okay. So for now, I think we have everything. Even in the footer, okay, all that you wanted to do is add an image. Okay. Search for an image that looks like this. Add that image over here. And then add like a list of links. Okay. So these are all links. Okay. So technically, you know, what we should have had is, it's a list element, but you also have like, you know, it's a link element inside a list, right? So we'll have something like this. So I just edited all at once. Okay. You may not want to do it. It gets a little confusing for you. So you can just, you know, you can make your list and add your links one by one. That's also fine. Okay, so this is what it's going to look like, the structure of the footer. You have an image, you have a list of links, and then you have another link for help. And then you have this, you have like a select tag to make a drop down. Okay, I'll just take a couple of questions before we go. Oh, absolutely, Vinay, absolutely. You can select the default value. All you have to do is you have to go to this option, okay? And suppose you've written it like English, French, and Hindi, okay? By default, it's going to, you know, select the first one that you have here. But suppose you wanted to select Hindi, okay? Then you would go ahead and you would say, you just add the attribute called selected inside the option tag, okay? If you save, then you'll notice that by default, it goes to Hindi, okay? And if you don't give that, basically, you know, it goes to English. You can go back and change it, obviously. But the selected tag basically, the selected attribute basically says, what do you want the language to be by default? Okay. So up until now, nothing very complex, right? I hope you guys are able to follow. Just give me a yes on the chat. if you've been able to follow so far. Very simple structure, guys. Header followed by footer. Okay. And inside the header, if you want to add an image, you'll use the img tag. In the footer, we wanted to add this image, so again we use the img tag. Okay. This src, okay, this is what tells us which image to load. All right. Yeah, guys, anybody who has a question, please ask on chat. All right. Yeah, please feel free to ask on chat. I'll get back to it after the next sort of break in our conversation. Okay. All right. So we have this here, right? Now, what I want to do is I want to make this look kind of like what these guys have, okay? Because otherwise ours looks pretty horrible right now, right? The images are all out of shape. And we don't need any of that. See, it's very simple. All I have to do is I have to find a way of saying, hey, this image, okay, make it much smaller. Like the width of this image should be much smaller. The width of this image, again, it can't be this big, right? So I want the width of this image also to be much smaller. These links, okay, I don't want it to look like this. Okay, I don't want it to come one after the other. I want them to come side by side. So this is what I want the links to start looking like. If I move them inside, this is what it will look. Yeah. All right. So this is what we want, okay? So the image, then this list of links, and then I want this help fellow. Okay, I want this guy. So let's see how we can do that. All right. The first thing that we're going to do is now we're going to add some CSS into the picture. Okay. CSS, I'm pretty sure you know all of this. I'm just repeating so that we're all on the same page. CSS is a way of telling the browser, hey, you draw, I drew an image, right? I drew this link. I drew the select dropdown. But the HTML can't really tell the browser how to draw it, okay? In the sense that all the HTML does is it's like, think about building a house, guys, okay? You have the blueprint of the house, right? What does the blueprint of the house say? The blueprint just says, hey, these are the rooms that I want to have. These are the, you know, this is the total square footage of my house. This is where the garden is. This is where my sofa, whatever. So that's the blueprint of the house, right? Does that mean your house will look exactly like the blueprint, or the blueprint looks exactly like the house? No, right? The blueprint is just a structure. A blueprint is just a way of telling the builder, telling the architect, hey, you know what? Make a wall over here. Make the garden over here. But it doesn't really say, hey, what kind of grass do you want on the garden? What color should be there for the walls? It doesn't really say any of that, okay? Similarly, HTML, whatever you've written so far, okay, you're just telling the browser, hey, put an image, put a link, put a list of items. But you're not telling the browser how to make it look like, okay? You can't tell using HTML what color these guys should be. You can't tell, you know, what size the text should be. All of that is done using CSS. Okay. So we're going to go ahead and we'll add some CSS over here. So open a new file called style.css. Okay. Come back to this page, index.html. Okay. And do you notice this head tag over here? I want you to go ahead and I want you to type in the word link, L-I-N-K. And then you'll see this dropdown over here, link CSS. Click on that. And it's very self-explanatory, right? What link would do. All it says is, hey, I know that the CSS for this HTML file is in a different file altogether, okay? This tag over here, this link, hrefstyle.css, is a way of telling the browser, hey, you know what? The CSS, you can find it in this file. Okay, that's all. That's all that we are doing here. We're just linking it. Now the style sheet is empty, okay? Which is why you don't see anything happen. But for now, this we have to set this up. Okay, if you take style.css, you have to link it back to index.html. All right. Now is where the magic begins. Okay. So this is one bit that I just want you to, you know, write with me. Okay. What I'm basically saying here is, for every element, okay, there are three properties that I want to reset. Okay. There are three like base properties that I want to give for anything that the browser ends up drawing. Okay. I want to say that there should not be any margins. There should not be any padding. And the box sizing should be border box. Okay. Now, what changed? Okay, what became different? So you'll notice if I didn't have this, okay, the browser, look at this list over here, okay. Let's just make it really big. Go down here. Look at this, okay. Now, I didn't tell the browser how to draw this list, right? The browser already has some defaults. It's going to say, hey, if you have an image, I'll just draw the entire image. If you have a list of items, I just draw the list of items like this. By default, I will give it this bullet icon, etc. I'll leave so much space over here. Notice this is not something we told the browser. The browser just kind of assumed it and, you know, went ahead and did it anyway. Aditya, we're just going to use CSS, like plain CSS, okay? So it'll be really simple to follow along. Don't worry. So if you do something like this, all right, what you're telling the browser is, hey, I know you by default, you set some values for margin, you set some values for padding, you set some values for this thing called box sizing. I don't want you to do that. Okay. By default, put everything to zero. And I will decide how much space there is between two elements. I will decide what their size is. Okay. So that's all that we are saying here. We're only saying, hey, we are going to decide what the size of these logos will be, what the spacing between these two items will be. Okay, so we are going to decide that by ourselves, right? So again, what did we do in the last couple of minutes? Create a new file called style.css, paste this code. Okay, don't worry about what star before and star after mean. Just focus on star for now, okay? So star is basically a way of saying for every element on the page, you know, reset the margin, the padding, and the box sizing. Okay. Now let's come back here and see how it is that we want to target these guys. Okay. So the first thing that you'll notice is I don't want the images to be this big. Okay. That's what I want to fix. Right. So I'll say something like, since my entire header section only has one image, I could say something like, hey, any image that is inside the header, okay, anything that was created with the image tag inside the header tag, okay, let's see what we want to do here. I want to limit the height of this one, right? I don't want it to be too big. So I could just say something like, the height of this image should not be should be exactly 30 pixels, okay? That's what I'm saying here. It will be exactly 30 pixels. And there you go. Such a simple thing to do. And you've already, you started limiting the height of things. Okay. It's very, very powerful that way. Similarly, there's one image in the footer. Okay. It's this image. So I can go ahead and I can say, hey, footer image, the height is, again, it's 30 pixels. Okay. Maybe just a little bit more than 30 pixels, something like 36. Okay. But again, yeah, it'll be here, right? And then I have this Gmail, and then I have these links, right? So now my job is to go ahead and to style all of that. Okay. So we're going to start off with the header. Okay. Just delete this. We'll start off with the header. Okay. We'll design this first. Then we'll go ahead. We'll design the footer next. All right. So let's see. So first of all, what do I want my header to be like? okay, I first of all, I wanted to have a white background. All right. So my header is basically both of these guys, right? This line and this line. So let's just say the background will be white. Okay. You'll notice that the entire page does not have the same background. Okay. Like this section has a slightly different background to this. This is pure white. This is like slightly off white. Okay. So we need to be a little careful while doing this. So let's set the header to white, the background of the header to white. Can't see because again, everything is white for now. The next thing I want to do is, you'll notice that the header has like a little bit of a shadow over here. Can you see? So if you scroll down, this guy has a little bit of a shadow here, right? So I want to probably add like a box shadow. Okay. So yeah, so let's see. So you can, I don't know if you can see this very well, but there's a hint of a shadow over here. Okay. Focus on this area now. Let me just comment out the footer so that we can just focus on the heading for now. Okay. Okay. So that's our header. You know what we did here, right? So we limited the height to about 30 pixels. Okay. We'll make it here. Okay, Sai, you've given an image in the source. Can you show where your image is? Like, can you paste the link over here? Or can you paste your HTML code here? I can probably take a look at it. Right, and Venkat, box shadow is really simple, okay? It's just a way of adding a shadow to an element. Okay, it's really that simple. There's this website that I generally used as a beginner. Okay, so just search for CSS box shadow. Okay, and there's this one called CSSmatic box shadow generator. Okay, so let me just paste the link in the chat. So guys, this is the website I use when I want to go and design shadows. Okay, you'll notice that I can play around with these sliders. Okay, so basically what this says is, if this is your box, okay, in HTML, CSS, everything is a box, right? So if this is your box, you can play around with the parameters to, you know, to kind of make sure where you want your shadow to be. Okay, sometimes you just want a horizontal shadow like this. Sometimes you want it to be, you know, exactly vertical. You can change the color of the shadow, for instance. All right. So you could probably make it something really, really light. All right. You could increase the radius. You can increase the spread, the blur. Okay. Blur means how diffuse that shadow is. So you can play around with all of this. And then finally, you'll get the code for box shadow. Whatever shadow you want, you'll get the code over here. So just go ahead and copy paste that. All right. I have some experience now. Since I've been doing it for a bit, so I can kind of look at a shadow and, you know, make like a estimate, okay, make a guess for what the shadow will look like. But again, it doesn't have to be that obvious, okay? Sometimes it's not that obvious, all right? Yeah, so go ahead, use that website, use the website that I just showed you. Okay, Venkat, don't go for this google.com URL sort of images, okay? What you need to do is you have to open this image, okay? For instance, I don't know if I can copy this. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Zoom is useless, guys. Won't let me copy this link over here, okay? But for instance, if you find something on Google Images, right? So that's how we did, right? Google logo transparent. Make sure that you actually go to that image. Okay, like click on this, click on view image, okay, or open image in new tab. All right, and if it starts with data image or something, you can use it. The other thing is, you can click on this, you can visit it in the actual website where they use it. Okay, you can say open image in new tab, and then you can copy a URL like this. Okay. you can use that. I think Chandu pasted another link. The problem with Zoom again is that you can't copy paste apparently from chat, or at least I'm not able to copy paste for whatever reason. So yeah, just take care, because sometimes those Google, because it's like a redirect, okay? Google is linking to somebody else's image, all right? So that sometimes it doesn't work. So make sure you copy the right, the actual image, all right? Now let's see, what do we have here, guys? We have two rows, okay? We have this, the first row, and then we have the second row, right? If it was actually just one big, so if you're on desktop, this is much simpler, because on desktop, it's actually just one row. You have your image, you have your the Gmail thingy, and then you have the three, you have the two links, and then you have the button, right? So if we were to do something similar for here, okay, basically sign in would be right at the very end. Yeah, so you'd have for work, sign in, and then this one button, right? So this get Gmail would be at the very end. So one way that we can do this, okay, is by using Flexbox, okay? What I can do is, see, I have an image, I have a span, and then I have these three guys, right? I have this get Gmail, for work, and I have sign in. So I have all these five elements, and I just need to position it in the right manner. One second. For some reason, you guys are coming in and going out of the Zoom call. It's a little distracting. Okay. Just a second. Okay, so now that you hear, you see that these are basically two rows, right? So what I could do is, I could just wrap this inside two different navigation tabs, okay? So I could do something like this, all right? You have your image over here, image and span is fine. And then what we could have done here is, for instance, you could have put all of this into one navigation tab, okay? One navigation tag. So these three links, okay, I'm going to put it inside the first navigation. And then these two links, I'm going to put it inside the second nav, all right? So what I'm doing is I'm putting them inside two separate containers, okay? My two links, okay, this get Gmail is in one container. These guys are one container. For work and sign in is another container, okay? So the benefit to that is, you'll notice over here, both of them are, they're not exactly, I mean, they're of the same height, right? So this is about, I don't know how much this is, about 56 pixels, 60 pixels probably. So you could say something like this. So you would say header nav, okay? So any nav element that we have on the header, okay, for us, I'm going to fix the height. Okay, I'm going to say height is 56 pixels, all right? So now you can see that, you know, this and this are, I could also give this a border just so that you guys can, you know, see what's happening. So previously I didn't have these containers, right? I didn't have this nav container and the second nav container. So what used to happen was all of these five elements kind of come in the same line. Okay. I don't want that, at least not for this view. I don't want it. I want these two to come in two separate lines, right? So this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to have this on one line. I'm going to have this on another line. So I just put them in two different containers. The first image span and link comes in one container. The second image span and link, the second links come in a second container. All right. So you have that. Okay. We can get started with kind of, the fonts, just making sure that the links work well. Okay. First thing I want to do is, you see that all of these links have the underline already set, okay? I don't want that. I don't want links to have their own underline. So I'm just going to say text decoration none, okay? So any link on the page, I don't want it to have an underline by default, okay? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to say something like font or color inherit. Basically what it means is it's going to inherit the color from the container that it is in. Okay, so if on the container, for instance, on header or header map, I end up applying a color, it's going to take that color. The other thing we can do is we can just actually give it, like the standard colors that these guys have. So you'll notice that they're a light gray, okay? And then they kind of become, when you hover over it, they become black, right? So we could just go ahead and give it like a really light color. Like something like 555 is okay. Or something like 666 is okay. All right, like a really light gray. And then you can say something like on hover, okay? If you hover over a link, then the color becomes black, all right? So now if I'm not sure if you're able to see this clearly on the call, but if you hover over this, these links now start to become black, all right? Which is pretty amazing, right? This is exactly what we wanted, like light gray links, but then when you hover over it, they become black. Right. Let's see. For all the elements by default, I'm going to start off with a font size of say 14 pixels. Okay. I'm going to keep it a little small. All right. So maybe 14 pixels is way too small. All right. Maybe we don't need 14 pixels. All right. So now what do we need? We need this Gmail to be much bigger, obviously. All right, so this span, we need that to be much bigger. We need the for work and sign in to be on two separate corners. And then we want this get Gmail to look like a button, right? So what I'm going to do here is, I'm going to say, this get Gmail, I'm going to give it a class name and I'm going to style my button that way. Okay, so let's see what all we need. First of all, for this button, you will see that the font or the color, okay, is white. The background is, it's blue, right? This blue. It's white, the background is blue. And when you hover over it, the color is still white, okay? So the color doesn't change, only the background color kind of, changes a bit, all right? So what we can do is we can actually pick out the exact color that these guys are using. Okay, so you just right click and go to inspect element. Okay, and you can find out what the exact color is. So go ahead and paste that in. Okay, I'm going to remove this over here, the A hover and this color. Okay, I'll remove that in just a bit. And then on hover, it changes, right? It becomes like a slightly darker shade of blue. All right. So click on this HOV, click on hover, and then you'll be able to see, the styles that get applied. So this color, okay, this slightly darker blue, I can say something like, hey, if anything with the button class, if I hover over it, make sure that the background is dark blue. All right. So now you can see the magic happen, right? Color is still white. So, but you see, it's starting to look more and more like this, okay? Which is really interesting. Now what I want to do is basically for a button, I just want to give it some padding, all right? So let's see, let's give it no padding on the top and bottom, okay? But on the sides, I just want to give it some 24 pixels of padding, okay? And what I could do, I guess, is I could make the line height as about 24 pixels. It's already 24, is it? Okay, so for button, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to put the height here directly, right? Make it 36 pixels. For some reason, it's not getting applied. Oh, okay, that's because it's, oh my god. All right. So what you're missing here is we just need to say display is inline block. All right. I'll explain why we need to do this inline block and all of that. Okay, I'll explain that in just a bit. But yeah, but for now, just follow along. All right. So the only changes that we made here were we went ahead. Okay. The same way that you have this button over here. Okay. We're going to go ahead and we're going to add like a property called display inline block to all our links. Okay. We're going to remove this red border. We don't need it anymore. Okay. And you see that we now have a button, right? So the button looks pretty okay. What we can do also is, for instance, this span tag. Okay. So let's just call it Gmail logo text. All right. So I'm going to give that class. And for this, I'm going to increase the font size first of all for this Gmail. So let's make it, I don't know how much, 24 pixels? Is that big enough? Yeah, okay, that seems big enough. It's not super big, but it's big enough. Then the color, obviously, right? The color is probably something like 333, okay? Or I don't know, 444 maybe. Yeah, slightly better color over here. And then we have the button. The button supposed to go all the way to the right. We'll fix that. Okay, let's see what else we need. We have these two links. Okay, and you hover over them, they go side by side. Okay, perfect, fantastic. So what we are going to do now is let's just end up taking, so we have a nav, right? So let's take the first nav, okay? So this header nav, right? I'm going to make it a flex display, all right? There you go. So we'll make it a flexible display, okay? Which means, these guys, okay, you notice the height of this, okay, this has gone a bit wrong. Okay, we'll go ahead, we'll fix that in just a bit. All right, so you have this, and then what I want to do is I want to make sure that, you know, everything is centered vertically. Okay, so I'm going to say align items center. Okay, so this centers everything vertically in this nav. If you can't see what the nav looks like, just add like a border and you'll be able to see. Okay. So if I didn't have this align items, notice how it's happening. It's getting stretched. Okay. To the height of this container. But if I say align items center, it's going to just take these three elements and align it vertically. Okay. It's going to align it vertically. And then now we don't need the border, right? So you notice that even these guys get aligned vertically, which is a nice bonus. Okay. The other thing that we kind of need is we'll say justify content. Okay. And I'm going to say space between. Okay. So all that this does is that whatever elements you have, okay, it's going to kind of align them to the center, but push them apart. Okay. This is what the entire point of Flexbox is. Okay, you draw your elements, and then using Flexbox, you can say how you want to space those elements out. For instance, over here, you'll notice that both of these they're sticking together. Okay, we'll come to that. We'll see how that's taken care of. But if you notice this guy and this guy, they're always spaced apart, right? Which means they're spaced as far away from each other as possible, right? So you can go ahead and you can add these two. Align item center will align it vertically. Justify content space between will just push them apart. The problem is, while it works out for everything else, okay, you'll notice that the logo and this Gmail, they also get spaced apart, okay, which is what you don't want, right? Because these guys are together over here. The simple fix to this, okay, is that you just put a div, okay, you make another container and you put both of them inside that container. Okay, so basically what you're saying is now for the flex box, okay, there are only two containers or two elements that it can push apart. Okay, it is one, you have this element, the other you have this element. Okay, that's one way of doing it. The other way of doing it obviously is, you know, you have all of this, but what you're going to do is instead of saying space between, okay, you're not going to say space between, you let it come, you let it stick to the sides. But what you'll do is we'll make another small class. Okay, we'll make a small class called push right. Okay, or something like, so I want to say margin right auto, okay? And this class, all it does is, it makes the, you know, makes the margin right as auto. So I'll show you what that means. If I add this class, okay, called MR auto, margin right auto, if I add it to this span over here, okay, notice what happens here. So there are multiple ways, guys, that you can, you can push things apart, okay? One way is using flexbox, okay? So you do flexbox and you say, hey, justify content, space between. So whatever is inside a space flexbox will get spaced out. It'll get separated, it'll get pushed away. The second way that you can do this is by using margins, okay? You can say, hey, give it an automatic margin to the right. And if you do that, very nicely. So for instance, that's what I'm saying for this Gmail here, right? This piece of text here. Notice that both of these classes are applying to it. So both the Gmail logo text is applying as well as MR auto is applying. Okay, which means no matter how big or small your screen size will get, okay, this Gmail fellow, okay, will always push the button all the way to the right. Okay, this guy will always push this button all the way to the right. Why? Because this has an automatic margin. Okay, you notice this this sort of slight pink part to the Gmail. That's the margin. Okay, it's automatic. So you're basically saying, hey, I don't want to tell you what exact margin you should have, but you know, just whatever comes to your left, just push it to the right. Push it all the way to the right. Okay. There's that. So the same thing we'll apply to this for work, obviously, over here. Okay, you can add a class over here called MR auto. So this is going to push sign in all the way to the right. Okay. And then one thing that you'll notice here, guys, is that there is some space over here, right? So it's not like our image is touching the very edge. Okay, whereas their image is not touching the edge. There's some space to the left and right. Okay, that's pretty simple to do. Basically, all that means is, you know, for this nav bar, we need to add some padding. Okay, and you don't really need any padding on the top, you just need padding on the sides. So you could add something like a 2% padding. Okay, so it's just going to bring it here. Okay, you could also do this in pixels. So you could have something like, say, 20 pixels, and it would push it, you know, I mean, kind of squeeze it inside by 20 pixels. Okay. But yeah, I'm going to go with 2% so that, you know, even when I make it much smaller, like if I keep reducing this, okay, it's not like 20 pixels is too much. You can have 20 pixels, you can have 2%, both will work out just fine. All right. And then you have for work and you have sign in. So what's left, guys? The only thing that's left is this tiny border here. Okay. So what we're going to do is to this navigation, we're going to add a border bottom. Okay. 1 pixel solid and like a really, really light gray color. Okay. So I think triple D should be a very, very light color. Okay. You notice how they have their color. Now we also have our color. All right. We have that. Again, what other things I can notice that our image is just a little bit smaller than what we need. Okay. So maybe I'll just increase it to 36 pixels, our image. Okay. And the text I'm going to, I need to increase that as well, right? So something like 28 pixels probably should be our text. And it should have like some spacing between the logo and the image, right? So I'm just going to say margin left, okay? And let's put about 10 pixels of space. 10 pixel probably too much. Something like 8 pixels, fine. Okay, so you have the image, you have the this guy, and you also have the button, right? You have button get Gmail. What's left? So you'll notice that get Gmail is actually, they have more of a padding. So where's our button? Okay, so it's not 30, let's keep it at 36. Okay, let's keep coming back to our thing. 36 is good. And finally, what we'll do is we'll add a little bit of border radius. Okay, just a little bit of border radius. Okay, and you can't see it on the Zoom call. It will be hard to see. But you'll notice that none of the Google buttons are very sharp. They don't have sharp corners. Okay, so do you see if I zoom in? Okay, you'll probably see this bit. Okay, if I don't give a border radius, this is going to be very sharp, like a 90 degree thing. I don't want that. Okay. So I'm going to make this, I'm just going to give it a hint of a border radius. Okay, just make it a little rounder. So 2 pixels, 3 pixels, that should be fine. Okay, you can play around with the font size here. Okay, something like 14 pixels is okay. Okay, a couple of things that Gmail, this landing page does, okay, which is not very obvious to people who see it, is that they use this property called as letter spacing. Okay, and letter spacing basically says even between these letters, this get space Gmail, okay, this Gmail, between these letters also they're adding a bit of space. Okay, so you note that even between G and between M there's a little bit of space. So that's what these guys do, okay, the Google engineers, just to make it look a little better. So they have that. Our links are fine. When we hover over our links, okay, everything seems to work. The only thing that's not the prettiest, okay, is the font. Okay, so we'll just go ahead and we'll fix the font. That's really simple to do. So go to Google Fonts, okay, go here and let's search for, like, just try to search for whatever font that these guys have. They use something called as Product Sans. So obviously Google will not have. So I'm going to use something like, I don't know. I'm trying to see if there's something that looks like, Google's page. Then you can go ahead and just use that. It's going to be hard to find. So I'm not sure. Let's go ahead with Work Sans. Okay. I don't know. I just think it's okay. So I'm going to go ahead and select all of these styles. Okay. You don't need all of these. Okay. Only select the ones that we'll end up using. But I mean, for this purpose right now, I just want to select all of them. And notice what this web page is telling you. Okay. This web page itself will tell you what to put. Okay. For instance, it's telling you, hey, take a link, and you know where to put the link, right? So you have to put the link over here. And then it says to specify that you want to use Work Sans instead of everything else, go ahead and, kind of put it over here. We have font family Work Sans. And if you do that, notice that our font has now changed. Okay. Earlier it used to be this, but now it is this. Okay. And is it the same exact font? It's not, okay. You probably need like a, I don't know what a better font is, guys. If you find it during lunchtime, let me know. And we can go ahead and use that. But for now, I think this would work just fine. Open Sans is also good. You could probably, you know, end up selecting this instead of Work Sans. So I'm just showing you again. Go on to fonts.google.com and use this to select your font, okay? And all you have to do after that is to click on, wait 1 second. Yeah, so click on this button here and it'll kind of tell you what you have to include. Okay. Make sure you don't like include all of the fonts in the world. Okay. Just use the ones that you use. So for instance, if I want to switch from something like Work Sans to Open Sans, okay, I'll go here and replace my link. Okay. 1 second. Yeah. I'll replace my link here. And over here, instead of Work Sans, I'll just say Open Sans. Right? And this is what my Gmail will start to look like. This is what my thing will start to look like. Okay? Not the same exact thing that Gmail has going, okay, for itself, but it's pretty close. All right? You can do small tweaks here, like, you know, set the font weight to 500, just make it a little bit bolder, okay? Font color could be much lighter, okay? Like this Gmail and this Gmail, okay? Font size could be smaller, I'm guessing. Yeah. And then similarly, for the button, you would have something like font weight. Just, you know, just increase the font weight so that the buttons look a little bit more bold, okay? Yeah, and there you go, there you have it, okay? The base font size, like for all the elements, I think we're just going to go ahead with something like 14 pixels to start with, okay? So then it, you know, it kind of looks like this, all right? Again, the Gmail will not look like Gmail because it's a different font, okay? Google has its own proprietary font called Product Sans. But you look around in that Google font repository, try to find out something that looks and feels like this, okay? So again, just a quick recap of what we've done. Make your HTML file, add your header. Inside the header, we basically, for every row, okay, each of these rows is a separate nav container. Okay, this is one nav, this is another nav. Inside the nav, the first nav, we have an image, we have some text, and we have a button. Okay, when you hover over the button, obviously the color of the button is also changing. So we have an image, we have a span, we have a link, and then for this nav, we have a couple of links. Okay, for work and sign in, so we have both of those. Over there, that makes up our header. Okay, what are the styles that we added? First of all, we said, hey, make all of the margin, all of the padding, just keep it to zero. Okay, I don't want any useless margin or padding on its own. I will decide what the margin and padding is. Okay, so you have that. Then you know, for every little element, you went ahead and you added the margin, the spacing, and all of that. For links, we went ahead and said, hey, you know what, don't make it underlined. Okay, I don't want underlines on my links. By default, I want them to be a very light color. Okay, but when I hover over them, so for all the link tags, the color is light gray. But when I'm hovering over any link tag, okay, the color becomes black. All right, that's what we kind of did here. And then we went ahead and said, you know what, the header, this header over here, okay, which has both of my navigation containers, the background is going to be white and you're going to have like a very small box shadow. Okay, there's that. And then finally, we saw how to align things, right? These three things, okay, I want two of them to come close to each other and one of them I want to throw it all the way to the right. So how do I do that? I make this a flex box, okay? I align everything vertically. Vertically, everything should be centered, right? All these three things vertically, they should be at the same level. Horizontally, I use the margin right auto property, okay? So for this element, if I give it a margin right of auto, it's going to throw whatever it has all the way to the right. Okay, similarly for work, I'm going to give it margin right auto, throws all the way over here. Okay, pushes it all the way to sign in, right? And that, ladies and gentlemen, is our navigation bar done, ready to go. Okay.
Hey guys, hope you enjoyed that video. We're one step closer to putting a beautiful web mini project on our resume. So I hope you're excited. I hope you're coding along with us. If you haven't signed up for the AWS Webmaster Bootcamp, the link is in the description below. Go ahead, sign up. The code for this entire project is available over there. You'll also get to chat with me and my team of mentors when you sign up for a free module. So go ahead, sign up, come say hi on the chat. We'll be more than happy to help you with this project. Or if you wanted to talk about web development in general, if you wanted some career advice. That being said, if you like the video, if you like the kind of videos that we're doing, if you like the kind of workshops that we conduct, don't forget to like this video, guys. Share it amongst your friends, spread the word, tell people about what we're doing. And finally, subscribe to our channel. Click on the notifications icon as well so that you'll get notified every time we do another of these series of videos, every time a new video is released. Hope you've had fun today, guys. I'll see you all in the next video.